please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Welcome back. Markets, as we just told you before going to the break, are a bit wobbly, but still indicating green as far as the big indices are concerned, Sensex Nifty and Nifty Bank. Let's take that backdrop and discuss more earnings. Capital First posted a healthy set of earnings as far as growth is concerned, but there were a couple of problem points, especially on provisions going higher. Gross NPA increased only marginally. V. Vaidyanathan, Executive Chairman, Capital First, joins us now. Good morning, Mr. Vaidyanathan. Thanks much for joining. Well, exactly that. Let me start with the point that the market was puzzled about. Why higher provisions? Have you come along from 120 to 90, or any specific reason why provisions are high?
No, if you compare the provisions of the last few quarters, in that sense, compared to last quarter, it's quite stable. But I must point out that in this quarter, we did recognize a particular developer loan, which is a 54 crore loan, as an NPA, on which we've taken a provision, 50% provision of about 26 crores. So but for that, actually, our provisions for this quarter would have been even lesser than last quarter. And as you know, real estate financing, we have practically stopped now.
Okay.
So basically, we feel that that's the only factor.
Okay.
But overall, the net NPA of the company is still, even after accounting for it, is still 1%.
Yes.
And but for that, provision would have been 0.8%.
Okay. And just because of that, is the cost-to-income ratio higher? 55.5. I've never seen such a cost-to-income ratio for Capital First. It used to be hugging the 50s.
No, it used to be around close to the 52 to 53%. You know, there are a lot of business which you're continuously investing in. For example, housing loan business is a factor we're continuously investing in. So on an average, despite investments quarter on quarter on new businesses, our return on equity has been consistently climbing. So we're quite happy. This quarter, we touched close to 15% return on equity, which is actually quite a landmark number for us.
No, I meant cost to income. Cost to income has gone to 55.5.
I understood.
I'm
saying it 55, we used to be 53, so it's not a material difference.
Okay. Mr. Vaidyanathan, good morning. Thanks so much for joining us. I wanted to understand a little bit more about how sentiment is as far as the loans are concerned within sectors like, say, consumer durables, two-wheelers, MSMEs. Where are you seeing the fastest pace of growth, and what do the next few quarters look like?
I'll tell you our numbers. For example, in our case, close to 57% of our loan book is the small and medium enterprises business. 37% is consumer financing. Consumer meaning even people who purchase even a used car, for example, it's all part of consumption items. Close to about 7% or 6% is the wholesale financing business. Now, for us, each one of these businesses are growth areas. And frankly, in India, you could see the sales of Maruti, you can see the sale of two-wheelers, you could see the sale of FMCG companies. They're all posting fantastic results. So on that space, I think the growth is looking very, very strong.
Okay. I just wanted to ask you about this one-time income and a one-time hit in Q4 that Capital First has seen. Can you just tell us a little bit what this is about?
The one-time hit we already talked about, there was
yeah.
one real estate loan of 54 crores, which we recognized as NPA this quarter. We have taken a 50% provision, and that's quite conservative. We believe that this entire money will be recovered in the times to come. We just wanted to show the developer and to everybody that we will come after you if you don't pay your dues, and we are not scared of declaring an NPA. So that's as far as the expense is concerned. As far as income is concerned, again, there was an offsetting figure of 23.5 crores, which we got as income from a customer, which was one time in nature. The net figure of all of these was actually, but for these items, would have been positive. Mm. Our net profit would have been 97.5 crore against 95 we reported. So as far as shareholders concerned, they should know that net of these items, we would have actually been positive.
Okay.
By 2 crores.
Okay. Well, it's a very impressive growth number as far as assets under management are concerned, 38% year on year and about 10% quarter on quarter. Can you guide us in terms of loan growth in FY19 as well? Which would be the sectors?
I described to you that in India right now, the grassroots economy is doing really very well, notwithstanding what we talk about in the macro, the corporate side. And our business is entirely predicated on that growth. And for us, we feel extremely comfortable guiding for a 25% growth on the loan book. Our profit after tax has been compounding at about 39 to 40% for the last 5 years, which is basically faster than the growth of the loan book of 25%. So we believe that trend should continue in the coming year as well, which means profit should outpace the growth of the loan book of 25%.
Okay. And what kind of, can you give us any color on what the loan write-offs have been in this quarter, and has the trend been higher than what you've seen in the last few quarters?
No, trend has actually been lesser.
Okay.
If you just analyze the numbers a little deeper and you take the provision numbers of the last quarter, but for the 25 crore item that we took this quarter to the NPA, the net credit loss for this quarter is actually lesser than last quarter, despite the loan book growing by close to 3,000 crores. So our credit loss numbers have begun to come down, and we believe this is a sustainable trend, which is one of the reasons we're guiding for higher profits in the coming year. Oh. In fact, this quarter, we are touch and go at 100 crores. We believe we are going to cross the 100 crores profit per quarter very soon, probably even next quarter.
When does the merger take effect? Is it October 1st? Is it for the second half?
First of all, I say I would make an important caveat subject to regulatory approvals.
Okay.
But we would say that the application has actually gone from IDFC Bank side, not from our side.
Mm-hmm.
And from what we hear, it's routine, it's on track, and no significant concerns have been raised to them at this point of time.
All right, Mr. Vaidyanathan, we will leave it at that. We will look forward to that merger and post-merger questions thereafter. Thank you very much for joining us with all those details about your earnings. So strong growth. But then we are only talking about the next couple of quarters after the merger. It will be a different story.
Okay, well, crazy moves coming in for PC Jewelers. 35% higher now and huge volumes. Crazy, crazy stuff going on over there. But the other stock to definitely look at this morning is Intellect Design Arena. Now almost a 10% bump up. We were talking about how the numbers have looked pretty good. Ashwini Gujral, Prakash Gaba are with us to give us some quick thoughts. Ashwini, any stocks that catch your eye now?
See, basically the consumer stocks are doing very well. So Titan, Jubilant, HUL, etc. So that's the place to be. Metals have come back from the lows, but not a whole lot. So HUL is a buy with a stop of 1450, target of 1510. Havels is a buy with a stop of 542, target of 570. And Bank of Baroda is a buy with a stop of 138, target of 150. You know, you would tend to buy into this decline, because chances are maybe a second half rally could be possible.
Okay, in fact, that was my question, Ashwini, on the indices. You reckon this is turning out to be a bit of a reversal day, especially the way the market breadth is beginning to crunch once again? Or, as you said, if you're buying, what would be your stop loss for the day then?
See, the stop loss for the day on Nifty should be 10,640, which is Friday's low. On the Bank Nifty, it could be closer to say 25,650 to about 670. The point is, if we had to come off, we would have been down 40-50 points on the Nifty by now. The decline is kind of mild, so the bears are trying their luck again. And if they fail, then chances are you could have a second half breakout. As I said in the morning, that the morning does not look like very strong.
Okay. Ashwini, just one follow-through. Have you looked at Colgate's chart? That stock is making highs of the morning now.
See, everything FMCG and consumer is making highs of the day. So Colgate is not an outperformer in that space. But overall, you would look at, say, HUL or Jubilant, those sort of stocks. Colgate is still kind of sideways.
Metals are doing well, actually. GSPL sale as well, and also the Hindalco, Vedanta, JSW steel variety. That's seen a bit of an uptick, at least in the past half hour. But anything in that space?
Well, maybe you can get into a Tata Steel or Vedanta, because, you know, crude, etc. Are kind of revving up. So chances are commodities could also participate in the rally.
Okay.
Prakash Gaba is also here with us. Prakash, so many stocks moving around on the downside, you know, Walkart, Ujjivan, Just Dial, Adani Power. Anything that you want to short today? And if not, what would be on your list?
Well, Walkart certainly is looking weak. The way it's broken down around 9%, possibly we could see some more downside here, maybe below 700 zones, maybe 680, 670 zones. I like to go for two stocks on the long side. I'll go with Dabur. That looks good. Can climb to around 379 zones, stop below 367. Mm-hmm. Jubilant Food is another stock that looks good to me. Can climb to around 2,650 zones, stop below 2,575.
Okay, by the way, we just spoke about PC Jeweler being up 36%. Make it only 26 now. All of a sudden, there's a 10% intraday nick that has come in on this one, and that's always going to be, of course, an issue with some of these stocks. But looking quite well. Just one last follow-through, Ashmani. Some of the metal stocks making highs of the morning. Which one would be your top pick in that pack?
Sure, it's a fairly positive opening, you'd have to say. Flat for the mid-caps, but better yet for the frontliners. Nischint Chawathe of Kotak Institutional Equities joins us now to talk about all the NBFC earnings that have come out so far. Nischint, hi, good morning. It's been a good quarter for most of the companies, but you tell us, which are the companies that you liked, where you still have buy calls?
Sure, good morning. NBFCs had an extremely good quarter across all the three parameters, which is loan growth, margins, as well as in terms of NPL reduction. I think across the board we've seen improvements, and a lot of stocks have rallied on the back of that. So, you know, to that extent, you know, we are not very sure whether from a long-term point of view there is value left in many of the names. Yes, in terms of near-term momentum, things are going to be strong. In this backdrop, the segment that we are finding fairly attractive at this stage essentially is housing. A couple of reasons. One is that a painful phase of RERA GST is behind us, which means that demand gradually starts picking up from here on. You know that the entire affordable housing bit is doing extremely well at this point of time. And in terms of margins, there was a very surprising rate hike across players sometime last month. You know, we would have ideally expected that because of the competition in housing sector, you know, this entire home loan pain will continue for a while. But the way home loan rates have gone up, it's been a surprise. So which means that in terms of pressure on margins, possibly the pressure on margins would be less than anticipated and the companies could surprise positively. And again, valuations, if you look at HDFC or LIC, have not really run up as much. And that's where we feel that there is value in these stocks.
Okay.
The other segment that we like at this point of time is the life insurance sector. I guess everybody is looking at the headline numbers saying that, look, you know, ULIP sales have been strong. They may not remain strong next year because of the fact that markets could be under some pressure. But the fact of the matter is that today all the large players are focusing a lot more on protection business. And protection business essentially has extremely high margins as compared to the savings products. So if around 40-45% of the value is getting driven from protection business and this remains an area of focus, then I guess, you know, these stocks would be, would land up being good investment over a period of time. And in that sense, the monthly insurance numbers or collection numbers would tend to be increasingly less relevant than what they were last year.
Okay. Nischint, are you not worried about the hectic pace of growth in some of the housing finance companies like Indiabulls and DHFL? Or do you think that the market's good enough and that's why the numbers are so good?
So one thing is that we don't cover these names, so it would not be very accurate for me to comment on this. But yes, if things are picking up on the affordable housing front as well, then possibly in some of the names I would want to worry less than what I would have been worried last year, because you know that fundamentally there are some tailwinds that are really picking up.
Yeah, but
so I don't have any specific comments on these names, but if the macro is positive, I guess it benefits everybody to some extent.
Okay. You were talking us about some of these housing finance companies. You like both HDFC and LIC housing finance in that space. But on LIC housing particularly, what kind of upsides do you see and what are you baking in terms of growth?
So we are looking at around 18-19% kind of loan growth, which really starts picking up from around 16-17% this year. The bigger issue here is in terms of the comfort on margins. We saw significant pressure on margins this year. Primarily because of the fact that while interest rates or the borrowing cost has not gone up, essentially on the home loan side, we have seen significant pressures. And the whole argument that we are making at this point of time is that, look, home loan rates are going up. So even if there could be some pressure on the borrowing side, the ability of these companies to kind of, at this point of time to kind of manage these margins is much better than earlier. We have a price target of around 600 rupees on LIC.
Okay. Is there anyone you would worry, not just housing, I meant among all the consumer durable, the entire range of NBFCs, about poor ALM mismatch because this cost of funds went up suddenly?
Yeah, so one thing, okay, what actually helped these guys last quarter was that many of them are engaged in PSL-related lending. So yes, we saw cost of funding going up in the month of March, but because these guys could downsell their portfolios, they were affected less. In the interim, maybe in last 1 or 2 months, they have been playing the yield curve, which means they're doing more of short-term borrowing than long-term borrowing. But they will need to bite the bullet, and they will need to raise, medium to long-term funding at a higher rate from now on, which means that margins will be under pressure. And which is what I said, that incrementally you will see margins coming under pressure, even if your asset quality and loan growth continue to remain fairly strong.
Okay.
So that is definitely a worry. The comfort that we have on the housing front is that your pricing power seem to be strong because you just seen a rate rise.
You downgraded anybody because of this worry?
I would not say downgraded, but yes, some of the stocks have run up on their valuation. So that's where we have kind of, corrected the rating by a notch for names like a PNB Housing Finance, or for that matter, even somewhere like a Mahindra, where we are saying that, the business is obviously in a sweet spot, but valuations are rich.
Okay, and finally, what about the wealth managers? You know, the Edelweiss, Motilal, that kind of stocks, they also saw a lot of rally for good reasons. You like them?
Yeah, so we have a coverage on IIFL, and this is one name which I think the company is fairly good, and this is the wealth piece is something which is extremely attractive at this point of time. But I guess, again, most of it tends to be priced in. I would put it this way, that these are the stocks which you typically buy when, the market is sort of a little flattish, rather than buying these stocks when, things are, everybody is very excited about the markets and, basically the way equity markets are going to play out. Mm. So maybe from a long-term point of view, may not be the best time to buy IIFL. Mm. But yes, it's an interesting theme, and post the demerger, I guess, IIFL will, the wealth business of IIFL will make more sense.